Welcome to Season 5 of Coffee with Dr. Stewart. This show will provide our listeners with up-to-date medical information from a leading neurologist and genomic specialist. I invite you to sit back, grab your favorite beverage or cup of coffee, and let's have Coffee with Dr. Stewart. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Coffee with Dr. Stewart. I am your host, Kara Stewart Mullins. And we have with us Dr. Kendall Stewart. How are you?
Oh, I'm doing great today.
The show is called Coffee with Dr. Stewart, but I don't see your coffee in front of you today. Oh, it's hidden.
Right.
Never mind. You got it. You got
it. Are you kidding me?
Well, we're glad to be back, everybody. This is season 5. We've done over 36 episodes and rocking and rolling here. But this is some new information today that we are going to tackle with Dr. Stewart. So, if you go back to season 1, we covered ADD, ADHD with Dr. Stewart, and great information, but things have changed. You know, it is a very common problem, not just among children, right, Dr. Stewart, adults, and it can come on at any onset of time of your life, correct?
Pretty much. I mean, by its definition,
And then sometimes kids can grow out of it, and sometimes adults can get it later in life due to stress and different things going on.
Yep.
Okay. I feel like I have ADHD from time to time.
You do. There's no doubt.
Thank you. Well, today's show, so like I said, so ADD, ADHD, two different terms going on there. So we're going to discuss that with Dr. Stewart. Then we're going to get into the new findings that he has in genetics and some of the treatments. And then we'll definitely cover some of the nutritional protocols. But Dr. Stewart, let's start with your definition of ADHD and ADD.
Okay, so my definition is always going to be different because I'm a chemist.
Right.
Okay, so as a biochemist and looking at treating the problem itself, you know, looking at a symptom and handing a drug is one thing, and that's kind of the way they want you to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But when we start breaking down the different types of inattentiveness, ADHD, et cetera, we found out that genetically, when we started looking at things genetically, they were actually far different things.
Okay.
And we also, a major thing happened that in 2015 that kind of has shaken the entire foundation of the psychiatry world.
In the treatment of ADD
and
ADHD?
The treatment of a lot of things.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And what happened is actually a new form of PET scanning was created in 2015, and they could actually label the microglia, which are the inflammatory cells of the nervous system. And this PET scan was used to see low levels of inflammation in the brain itself.
Oh, wow.
Because that's what a PET scan does. And what happened is they took it and they looked at, of course, severe disease, and they found inflammation. But when they started looking at anxiety, depression, ADD, sleep disorder, all these very, very common things, they found inflammation in the brain in all those conditions.
Like constant inflammation?
Correct.
Okay.
Fluctuate inflammation.
Oh, okay.
And so all of a sudden, the psychiatry world had a huge dilemma on their hands. And why that was true, we knew it was coming because, you know, as neurosurgical type of people, when you operate in and around the brain, you certainly find out that the brain doesn't quite work as well when you start messing with it.
Right.
Okay, so inflammation plays a big role, and we knew that inflammation was there because we could see it on some of our tests. But it had to be proven to the psychiatric.
Well, they're not the ones cutting it open and seeing the brain and seeing the inflammation.
Well, and so what happened is, when we looked at concepts of rapid change, let's say that you're fine 1 hour and you're not fine 3 hours from now.
Okay.
There is no way neurotransmitters can change that fast.
Really?
There's just no possibility of that.
What is the normal range of a
a neurotransmitter, let's say you get depressed. You will get depressed over several days to
right.
a week.
It gets worse.
Okay, and so it just kind of slowly deteriorates the neurotransmitters, and that makes perfect sense from a chemical standpoint.
Right.
But, for instance, bipolar is the easiest thing to understand. You can become manic within a few hours.
Right.
And there's no way neurotransmitters work that fast. So what happened is we really were able to determine that rapid changes or rapid fluctuations were more inflammatory,
okay.
and more long-term changes were more chemical, biochemical.
Oh, very interesting.
And so what that did for us meant that we had to then tackle two problems. And now I just recently looked back at the literature on that type of PET scan, and now there's well over 150 articles
wow.
on that form of PET scanning documenting inflammation.
In 3 years?
Yeah, in inflammation and different scenarios of neuropsychiatric disease.
So it's true.
Sure. And so what we knew is that we would put some kids on ADHD medicines, even though they were diagnosed with ADD or ADHD, and they do terrible.
Right.
And so what happened is we had to kind of back up and say, okay, what's going on? So when we went over and we started looking at the kids with ADD, ADHD, and we looked at their inflammatory markers, we found out there was a very unique pattern that was emerging in all of them.
The genetics,
that they were typically highly inflammatory people. Meaning
they couldn't control inflammation.
Well, they set it off a lot more aggressively than
people.
Their on switches were really
aggressive.
That's
what you talk about, like turning it on but never being able to turn it off.
And the biggest problem was they couldn't turn it off. And so the thing is, when you have a child that has good days, bad days,
mm-hmm.
that is not neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters don't go up and down every
very
day.
Very interesting.
Do you understand?
Yeah.
Because it's just very difficult for the brain to do that biochemically. But inflammation can go up and down every
right.
day.
Right.
Do you understand? And so we had to tackle inflammation, and then we had to tackle neurotransmitters at the same time.
Okay.
And then what happened a little bit further into that is that we started noticing there were different types of ADD. There were these ADHD kids that would not stay in their seat, run around,
right.
disrupt the classroom, and that was a dopamine thing. And we kind of knew that. And ADHD medicines, if you're going to squeeze dopamine out of the system, works great for that.
And what do you mean a dopamine thing? Like more of
meaning they didn't have enough dopamine.
To get them through the day.
Yeah. But then there was this quiet child who's just spacey, mm-hmm. inattentiveness, lacking focus, and I hear that all
quiet, not necessarily disruptive.
Not disruptive, but just not focused, just
right.
not with us, okay? Well, that turned out to be a completely different neurotransmitter. That turned out to be glutamate-GABA balance.
Ah, okay? I know where you're going.
And so we now actually have separated the way we actually treat the ADD based on symptomatology, based on genetics,
uh-huh.
into treating it in several different forms and fashions, which we'll talk about.
Depending on the genetic status.
Correct.
Very okay? interesting.
So it is much more complex than anybody wants to make it. And I can't tell you how many people wind up in my office. My child was ADD. We knew it's ADD, but we put them on stimulants and they did terrible.
Right. I hear that.
All the time. And so when we try something to help glutamate GABA balance, those children do much better.
Those are completely different treatments.
Correct.
Okay.
And we can talk through all those things. So glutamate basically is a stimulant. It is the most prevalent neurotransmitter in your brain. You have more glutamate than anything.
And tell us I've always wondered, what is glutamate? What does it do? Why is
so
it there?
Glutamate is basically an amino acid.
Okay.
It's called glutamic acid. And it's one of the few amino acids that we use as a neurotransmitter. And what we're supposed to do is take an enzyme called GAD1,
mm-hmm. It's a hard gene.
glutamic acid decarboxylase
right.
1. And we're supposed to convert, I always tell people, about 40% of our glutamate to GABA. So that we
okay.
have this nice balance of 60% stimulation, 40% calming. So GABA is a calming.
And the glutamate has to be converted to GABA.
Well, it has to because you have to have a balance in the system.
Okay.
So glutamate is a stimulant, GABA is a calming agent, and God wants us to have a nice balance.
Okay.
Okay. The problem is when you have a mutation in the GAD1, which is very, very common, then what happens is you don't convert enough glutamate into GABA, and so your brain runs at a very high speed
mm-hmm.
and eventually starts to wear itself out because there's no off button. So those people not only have inattentiveness, spaciness, especially as they get further along in the day.
Right.
They also can't shut their brain off at night and go to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
They have muscle spasms because GABA also relaxes the muscles, so they keep
right.
a lot of tension in their muscles. They have typically constipation because GABA relaxes the bowel, so these are kids that can't go to the bathroom very
right.
well. And in general, what you have to do is try to reestablish that balance. But the problem is if you start putting GABA in, which would make sense,
mm-hmm.
it breaks down to glutamate, so you make the situation worse.
And then you have too much glutamate and you're excitatory.
And you're even worse.
Oh.
So I hear all the time, we took these kids, we put them on some GABA to calm them down. They were great for 2 days, and then they went wild.
Yeah, because, you know, our calming cream has GABA, but there's some kids that the parents, it should relax you, and same with the mm-hmm. Mood Plus, and same with the other products that have GABA, and it's an opposite reaction. That's like probably 20%.
Oh, it's even more.
You think, now
yeah.
that we have the genetic proof.
And the adult, when you have all that stimulation, what you wind up going to is alcohol,
drugs,
marijuana,
yeah.
Downers, to
yep.
try to get control of that. And part of it's opiates, too, this big opiate addiction. You're actually treating that.
Because you have anxiety.
Well, it's not just anxiety, but once you get pain, your nerves are extra stimulated.
Absolutely.
So the pain is actually worse. So these are people who have pain that exceeds what it should.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying in their mind.
Right.
And so what we have to do is we have to either block the glutamate down and or try to provide GABA. And blocking the glutamate turns out to be the easiest. And the ones, the things that do that are amantadine is one of our favorites.
That's which a prescription.
Is a medication. It's a prescription medication. It's actually from the 70s. You're going to find out.
It's Dr. an antiviral.
Stewart,
is that correct?
Well, that's what it was touted at, but it's a glutamate blocker.
Oh, okay. How you always use it for different stuff.
Yeah. And it's a glutamate blocker, and the GABA receptor is called the NMDA receptor.
Right.
And so we have amantadine, and the newest one's called Namenda, which they use a lot in elderly people.
Prescriptions. Mm-hmm. Okay.
We have, and those are actually made from anise, the spice.
Okay. Interesting.
Then we have elderberry. We have anise. And so anise is really found in a lot of things, found in licorice. So if you have somebody who loves licorice, they usually have that.
A GAD
mutation.
One.
A pho soup at the Thai restaurant.
That would be me.
Or pho, as you're supposed to say it. Yeah. Chai tea has anise in it. And the Mexican culture and the Indian cultures and some of the Asian cultures cook a lot with anise.
Right. Mm-hmm. And can you find that in a supplement? Because we don't have that.
No, we don't have it, but we have parts of it.
Yeah. Right, parts of it. Okay.
And then we can also do it with dextromethorphan.
What's that?
That's over-the-counter cough medicine.
Oh, interesting. Mm-hmm.
And so there's some new avenues of calming the glutamate receptor with dextromethorphan. In fact, there's some a new medicine called Nudexta that they're using in elderly to keep their brain calmer.
Okay.
But you want to control glutamate because, in essence, what happens when you have too much glutamate is the cells never get to rest. They're just going nonstop all the time, and they wear themselves out.
Now, for those that know neurobiologics, the line you make, is that the ProGAD that you...
Okay, so the other way to attack it. Okay, so you can use natural things to calm glutamate.
Like you can just go to the store and get...
Sure, you can go to the store. Or you can go get a prescription. So amantadine is our favorite because it's an old, gentle, very well tolerated. The side effect profile is ridiculous because it's been out since the 70s.
So there's very little.
Always remember that those are written by attorneys.
Oh, well, you have to CYA, cover your butt.
That's what they are. They're never written by doctors.
Right.
It's just an attorney. If you
They're
get
not written by patients, no. That's for sure.
And so the biggest problem is affecting the GABA.
Right.
And so actually the Russians helped us a lot with this. So I always tell my patients, I haven't seen very many Russian descent people that don't have a GAD1 mutation.
Right.
And so I always say, what do they do all day? And they always go, drink vodka.
Well, we think that. I don't know.
Well, the answer is they do quite a bit. And it's really interesting that they felt it was such a problem in their population that when they had the cosmonauts that were going to fly in the space lab, they actually created a drug called piracetam that they could send up with the cosmonauts to actually calm the cosmonauts.
You always have the most interesting stories.
And so that now is available over the counter. They've changed it to phenylparacetam, and it's kind of hard to find.
Right.
And they also created another form of GABA. It's called beta-phenyl-GABA or phenibut.
Yep.
And phenibut was created in Russia also. And that's what we decided to change all of our GABA formulas to, beta-phenyl-GABA.
Like the calming cream now has beta-phenyl-GABA. The Mood Plus will soon.
Right. It's because it doesn't convert back to that glutamate.
Right.
And so we can
take So just to clarify, because I get this question already, because it was announced that the calming cream was coming out with the beta-phenyl, the phenibut. Does that mean that anybody, whether they have a GAD1 or not, can take it and it'll be effective?
You can take it. It's just that these are the people that will benefit.
It will not have the opposite effect.
Right. So when you have a receptor that just isn't used very much, when you finally hit it, it's going to be much more effective for somebody who lacks GABA.
So GAD1s will definitely feel that.
They will love it. Well, in fact, that's what it's indicated for.
I remember, if you're a doctor listening, and at Dr. Stewart's workshop a year ago, and you said, that dang GAD1, I'm going to figure this out because there are so many people who have it. I just don't know what to do about it.
Yeah.
And then you came up with the ProGAD enhancer, which has been a game changer.
It's been great. And, you've seen the reviews on it.
I don't have a double GAB, but, man, I love it. It makes me feel good.
Tell them about Dr. Johnson.
Well, we had a doctor that's been off and on using our products, and he said that he had given it to himself, who had MS, and who had always struggled with depression and some other things, along with his son, who apparently have similar genetics. And he wrote us the email that he had never had a supplement change his life and his family's life more than the ProGad, which is amazing.
So the answer is it can't hurt you in its form.
Right.
The ProGad is glycine, which is another way to actually help glutamate, which is an over-the-counter amino acid, and I forgot to mention that. Magnesium also and zinc. You know, you hear about people taking magnesium at bedtime and zinc.
But you got it all in one.
That's all in one. Okay.
Yeah.
And so that's part of the inattentiveness. And then we have the dopamine portion, which is mostly ADHD, which is that hyperactive child that can't sit still.
Right.
And, you know, that's really a dopamine thing. And remember, dopamine is made from tyrosine using 5-methyl. Well, it's actually made, converted using what's called tetrahydrobiopterin.
Okay.
And what happens is when dopamine is made, tetrahydrobiopterin breaks down to dihydrobiopterin. Mm-hmm. And it has to be remade to tetrahydrobiopterin and methylfolate is what makes the conversion.
You know, all these terms is like, oh, these are over the course of many, many years, all the stuff, and it's finally coming full circle.
Well,
for
it's
a lot
just
of things.
That's why methylfolate is so important. I like to think of it as the gasoline for the entire physiology of the cell.
So those people that have a GAD-1, the methylfolate is extremely important.
Right. And so, well, it's GAD-1, and also you got to check the methylation markers.
Right,
too,
as always.
Know. Yeah. You know, so in general, the way we approach it now, we don't methylate, and we'll talk about treatment, but if you got to be really careful with methylation before you calm inflammation.
Is that especially if they have a GAD-1 because they are very sensitive?
So, you know, we'll talk about it in the second half of this process.
But, okay.
But, you know, you've got to have, you got to follow the steps. I like to tell them that in college, you probably have never heard this story, but I called mom when I finally got my own apartment, and I asked her for a spaghetti sauce recipe.
Right.
And she told me what was in it and everything. So I wrote it down. Well, she didn't tell me to brown the onions and the garlic.
Yeah.
So what I did is I threw it all together, and it was crunchy and
nasty. Yuck.
And, you know, and I called mom back. And,
this is terrible.
I said, Mom, that was awful. And she goes, what? You know, that's
no,
delicious.
I told you that to brown that. No,
and then,
you didn't.
Yeah, she goes, and yeah. So we finally figured out I didn't brown the onions and the garlic first. And she was like, well, sweetie, you just got to do that.
That's,
you know,
like Brad made stew, our famous family stew, and he forgot to brown the meat before he added everything. He thought the meat would cook with it.
Right.
And we started eating. It was a bunch of raw pieces in there. Right. Yeah. So I get it. You got to have everything done the
right
way.
Timing is super important.
Well, we're going to take a quick break. And when we get back, we're going to talk a little bit more about the ADD, ADHD findings. And we're going to talk about treatment protocols. We'll be right back with Coffee with Dr. Stewart.
Do you or a family member have trouble concentrating, staying on task, remembering things? Does everyday life stress you out, or are you in a bad mood? Well, we may have just the solution. Neurobiologics' new nutritional formula, Full Focus, created by leading neurotologist and neuroimmune specialist Dr. Kendall Stewart, with 12 active ingredients carefully crafted by a physician to maximize brain performance, memory, and mood. For more information on this product and to view a video by Dr. Stewart explaining how Full Focus works and may be helpful to you or your family, please visit neurobiologics.com. Neurobiologics, where our mission is your health.
All right, everybody, welcome back to Coffee with Dr. Stewart. We're on season 5, and we are talking about ADD, ADHD, and new findings, treatment protocols. So, Dr. Stewart, we left the last half talking about the treatments and the new genetic findings that have changed the way you treat a lot of these symptoms.
And so, from the treatment standpoint, you got to follow a recipe. It's kind of like following the steps that are important. So, methylation's always needed to make dopamine and have energy and everything.
Right.
But what we've learned is if we don't control the inflammation first and we start methylating that child, we're going to be feeding the immune cells too. So we make the inflammation worse.
When you say feeding the immune cells, does that mean the methylfolate feeds it?
The methylfolate feeds it. And so we take and we we start to calm the inflammation. And we use things like PEA. We use hemp oil. We use low-dose naltrexone if the inflammation is there and
just
if you have the inflammation markers. Mm-hmm. You can use fish oils, too, and there's even some prescription ones that some people like to use. But you've got to control that inflammation first.
Okay.
And then secondarily, you have to come in and calm the glutamate. So, you know, we'll use prescriptions on occasion, like amantadine, and we'll use Progad. A lot of people love the Full Focus.
Right. That's a big popular
and
product.
That Full Focus is really made for those dopaminergic problems and, you know, people swear by that stuff.
Oh, I know. I know.
And, and so then we make sure that we've got all that under control, and we do it for about 3 to 4 weeks.
Okay.
And then we come in and methylate that child.
Yeah, many years ago it used to be methylate.
Right, and that's where the overmethylation came from, remember?
Right, but it wasn't.
So what happened is we were putting in the methylfolate before we actually calmed the inflammation. And so those children were exploding, and we thought we were overmethylating. But what we were really doing is we were just feeding the immune system.
And that's not even with children. That's adults. That's anybody.
Sure. And so, you know, a lot of times you have to also help these people learn how to wind themselves down, you know. And so, in general, you know, you want some Progad in the evening for a lot of these kids.
And you can take it during the day, too. So, you know, I know that it was you talk a lot about the evening, but I personally take it during
Well, I tell people to take one in the morning and typically take two or three at night.
Yeah, two in the morning, and I am feeling good.
Well, and, you know.
Everybody's different. You always call me weird.
Well, what I don't want to do is lose the effect.
Right. You know? Okay,
so
that makes sense.
I tell people to ease into it. And so once we get that under control, we've all of a sudden had a lot of these kids that their inattentiveness does improve. Now, this doesn't work on every single person.
Of course.
In fact, genetics can guide us. We can actually look at your genetics and typically tell how effective it would be for
right.
you. And, you know, genetics just make everything precise, meaning we're looking. I tell people when you come to my office, you have to be selfish. You're here for either yourself or your son. You're
right.
not. You could care less about the rest of the ADD kids in the world.
Right. You just it's because something it's about you. That's
right.
Different.
It's about you come to me for your child or you. You need to walk in here. When you see me, you got to be selfish.
Right.
Now you can walk out and be very philanthropic
and
this is great. I want to help everybody. But when
right.
you come to the office, you got to be selfish. And so really, it's made a big impact on you know, our whole concept of this ADD,
right.
ADHD, and that's why we've kind of reviewed it. It also has to do with memory loss and problems with that. And
long-term.
We also see some of these kids also get into trouble with a little bit of autophagy, meaning that we think that they're getting into...
And the autophagy is?
The autophagy is the cleaning of garbage out of cells.
Okay.
And so that's the ATG mutations.
Okay.
Specifically ATG16L1, which is currently on the genetic profile. We have a lot of new ones coming out. But
right.
if there's too much garbage in the cell, a lot of these kids also get into trouble delivering glucose to the cell.
Okay.
So it can actually interrupt and make them slightly insulin resistant. And so we like them also to be on some metabolic enhancer.
Yeah, that's that new dechiroinositol.
Dechiroinositol, and that helps a lot too, especially in the child who eats lunch and then kind of fades out
yeah.
after lunch, which is really, really a common thing.
Right.
So it's a lot more complicated than people like to think. It's not here's your medicine and go on your way.
Yeah.
And in fact, I had a teacher the other day, I have to tell you, she came in and brought her son, and we talked about all this. We spent about 45 minutes, and she looked at me and she said, Dr. Stewart, I just feel so awful. And I said, why? And she goes, well, I'm a teacher, and what I've been pushing
right.
for these kids has
Drugs.
Been the wrong thing for all these years.
Well, that's what they're trained to do.
Sure. And so I told her, you know, you obviously had the kids' best interests in mind. And
right.
you know, you need to not beat yourself. But she said, can I send them all here? And I'm like, no.
Well, you got to wait 2 years.
No.
Well, here's the problem with the teachers, and I feel for them because, you know, they're trained that, I mean, if you've got even two inattentive kids, it's a struggle. It
yeah.
disrupts the whole class. So you got to tell
23.
The parents. So the parents are at home or they're at work and they don't know what to do and they hear that their kid's messing up the whole class. And so what are they supposed to do?
Sure.
They're trying to go to a drug. Now my question is to you. So you talk about the child and what we can do now. I mean, is ADD something? It'll never be fixed.
No, because it's a genetically programmed
right.
process. And especially with kids, you know, kids are growing all the time.
Right.
And so, you know, there's not a sharp teenager out there. I'm sorry. They're all, because there's so much, well, there's so much inflammation going on. And I made a bunch of dumb mistakes.
Right.
And I know you did too.
I never did. Never.
So, you know, in general, what we just want to do is we want to specifically address the problems that are individual to that patient.
Okay.
We wouldn't have known anything I'm just talking about without genetics.
I know. It's
and
a
so
game changer.
It's just it's a game changer for us. And, you know, I wanted to reshoot this because I was excited about the changes.
Well, I'm going to pull the old episode down because we did that back in 2014.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and all the stuff that's changed since then has been amazing. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate your time today. I'm excited to hear all this because I didn't even know all this. And I think there's I call it game changers in different types of treatments, natural and what Dr. Stewart is doing. So we hope you enjoyed yourself. We thank you again for joining us. If you need more information on products mentioned, you can go to neurobiologics.com or visit us on coffeewithdrstewart.com. And we thank you and have a blessed and beautiful day.
This show is intended for general information and entertainment purposes only. Dr. Stewart serves as the Chief Science Officer and Lead Formulator for Neurobiologics and advises you to consult with your own medical professional on any information given during this programming. This information is not intended to diagnose, treat, or cure any disease or medical condition.